Shifting sands reflect change that is gradual and never-ending, making it an apt theme for this year's Eval Fest. It was a three-day evaluation festival that brought together some of the world's finest sector experts, creating a melting pot of ideas, innovations, and insights. We at Sambodhi are deeply committed to bringing these learnings to you, but with a twist of our own. Presenting Evidence Dialogues, a conversation series born out of the many stories that were left uncaptured during the sessions at Eval Fest. With this series, we bring to you a stellar lineup of sector experts talking about their experiences and the countless learnings they've gathered in their journey of bringing transformation. We spoke to Marco, Director of the Independent Evaluation Office at the UNFPA, about the shifting sands in evaluation, bias in humans versus bias in AI, and data privacy and ownership, among many other things. Stay tuned for the conversation. Thank you so much for joining us, Marco. It's a pleasure to have you here. Since the theme of EvalFest is shifting sands of evaluation, I want to understand how you perceive it. What do you think about the topic itself?
Well, definitely a very fascinating topics and very relevant and timely topics. You know, the world is living in a multi-crisis context, and so evaluation is more and more relevant and more important. But to remain relevant, it should really be responsive to the needs. It should be adaptive. It should be able to adapt to the shifting sands, exactly. And as the conference is saying, it should be also future-proof. So it should be forward-looking. And for that to happen, I think there are several things that should happen, but mainly two. The first one is really the meaningful engagement of young people in evaluation. We should really create intergenerational partnership between the senior and the young evaluators. And the Eval Fest here is just a practical example because it was co-organized by the Evaluation Community of India and Eval Youth India. And the second aspect is really about leveraging artificial intelligence for empowering evaluation.
Right. In fact, when we talk about AI and ML, it's also perceived as a tool that will help eliminate human incompetencies. I don't know, maybe that's not the right word. Human bias, right? So one of the reasons why people prefer that is to eliminate bias in terms of use of AI and ML. But, for example, we have natural language processing, the tech we have that, and it does everything that it's supposed to do, but at the same time, it can also not process languages as we do, process data as we do, think beyond what is given to the software, right? That is a specific skill that a seasoned research professional develops. My question to you is, do you see a time where AI and ML can take that ability and then create something out of that skill as well? Can it become like a seasoned research professional?
Thanks a lot. I mean, very interesting questions. First of all, about the aspect of bias, I think that the issue is not that artificial intelligence is going to eliminate the human bias. Actually, that's one of the big risks. One of the big risks with artificial intelligence is that artificial intelligence will actually multiply human bias. Because artificial intelligence, all the algorithms are written by human being and they reflect the human reality, the real world. And therefore, it's very important that we make sure that artificial intelligence is not a black box. It's very important that we make sure that artificial intelligence, we humans have oversight on artificial intelligence. And therefore, a way to reduce this potential risk about amplifying bias is exactly by making sure that humans are always in the control of artificial intelligence. Now, the second aspect of your question, I don't think that machine will ever completely replace humans. So in this case, I'm not afraid of losing my job to a machine. Actually, I'm pretty sure that I will not lose my job to a machine, but I'm pretty sure that I will lose my job to a person, an evaluator, who is very familiar with artificial intelligence. And that's why I'm always saying that we as evaluators, we should really not embrace artificial intelligence as it is, not resist it, but we should actually engage with it and shape it to make sure that it will be an ethical and responsible use of artificial intelligence.
Right. Can you give an example about the same? What do you mean when we say ethical use of artificial intelligence in especially the development sector?
Well, first of all, that, you know, artificial intelligence should be guided by the human rights principles. So, for example, nowadays there are no international regulations on artificial intelligence. And it's very interesting to see that actually they are the CEO of the big, multinational IT companies. They themselves, they are asking governments, they are asking the United Nations to come up with regulations for artificial intelligence, because they themselves, they see the potential risk of artificial intelligence if it's not regulated. That's why a number of governments and the United Nations, they are trying to come together exactly to come up with these international regulations. And these international regulations are based on some key principles. So as I was mentioning, the first principle is that everything should be based on a human rights base. So the second is about transparency. It should be very clear how artificial intelligence works, based on what the analysis is done, based on what principles, etc. And many more, all the aspect of privacy, all the aspect of cyber security, etc. So there are a lot of principles that should govern artificial intelligence. So if those principles are applied and respected in artificial intelligence, then we have ethical and responsible artificial intelligence.
You mentioned data privacy. And yes, it is extremely important for us to develop protocols around the same, and we're in the process of doing that as well, right? But as a community, how do we involve the stakeholders, the data providers, the data owners, to also understand the potential threats that are part of the process? Because cyber attacks are very, very common, and all the data is very, very risky as well to deal with, right? How do we then involve them in the process of, kind of understanding together how we can safeguard data and increase data governance in that manner?
Absolutely. I think we have an important role to play, both as community, but also as individual actor. As community, I think that we really need to come together and really to raise public awareness about this issue that you are mentioning. So raise public awareness, even kind of education, to the public and to our stakeholders, so that they are aware of that and they can also decide if they want to engage or not, and if so, how. In the case, for example, of UNFPA, what we do in our evaluation office is that when we contract out evaluations to external evaluation teams, to consultants, for example, they have to sign a disclaimer on the use of artificial intelligence. A disclaimer where they have to state, first of all, if they are using artificial intelligence or not. Second, actually, they have to request an authorization from our side, so that we have to say, yes, we agree, but we say, yes, we agree only based on the protocols, only once we are sure that the system or platform, artificial intelligence platform that the consultant use, they are aligned to our own principle of ethical and responsible evaluation that include also privacy of data. So I think that if we have an important role to play as individual stakeholders, but also as community.
But for that, capacity development is central, right? And with the oncoming of AI and ML becoming part of the processes that we're doing in this sector, we also need to understand how we can develop capacities that way. What is your take on this?
Absolutely, because, you know, we are evaluators, we are not IT specialists. So, for example, in the case of UNFPA, the first step that we did is that we had a very participatory and inclusive process, even within our team, within our staff, to build a culture for ethical and responsible artificial intelligence. The second step was exactly to have trainings, especially on the prompting, because, you know, it really depends how you prompt artificial intelligence. On the way that you prompt artificial intelligence, the results that you get back can be very, very different. So it's absolutely that there will be needs for training and for actually for on-the-job learning, because that's what we are doing. We are just learning about, applying artificial intelligence to our evaluations. There is nobody that is coming to us telling us, okay, you should do in this way and the other way, because it's something very new. Mm-hmm. So you have to be very intentional in what you want to do. And that's why, for example, we did a need assessment on to find out how artificial intelligence can help us to improve the efficiencies of our evaluations. And based on that, then we came up with a strategy on how to apply ethical and responsible artificial intelligence in our evaluations. But all of this was always done together with our legal department, right, with our IT department, and with our knowledge management department. So that's internally to the organization. And then it's very important to have this conversation also externally as a global evaluation community to make sure that everybody is on board. Because the big risk about artificial intelligence is that somebody will be left out. Mm. And the big risk is that the global south will be left out. You know, all the big companies that are developing artificial intelligence are in the global north. Mm-hmm. So it's very important that we come together as a community so that artificial intelligence can serve the purpose and the needs of the entire world and not only of a part of the world.
Right. And eval fest is the way to do it.
Exactly.
Thank you so much for your time, Marco. It's been a pleasure.
Thanks. Bye-bye.